at us.
Good morning and a warm autumn welcome to you this morning, Trinity Church. Let's go ahead and stand and sing. We have a new song, our monthly new song, Lay Me Down. If it's not familiar to you, just listen. If you do know it, feel free to sing along. Continue worshiping with a little more familiar song.
Mm-hmm.
Turn this thing on. There we go. Good morning. I'm glad that you're joining us this morning. And if you're watching online, we're so glad to have you online as well. Quick couple of updates. You have, of course, your bulletin in front of you, which has lots of different details about different things in it. I don't think I'm in the camera, so let me stand over here. This is a much more comfortable place to be. So first things first, many of you have asked, and I really appreciate my family, appreciate your prayers and your concerns. My dad did go back into the hospital. His blood oxygen was very low at home, so they put him on a steroid treatment that starts with an R, and I don't remember the name of it, but it's the same thing that the president received. He is doing much better, although when I talked to him yesterday, he didn't necessarily feel much better, but his blood oxygen level is much higher. It was super low at home and there in the hospital without even being on oxygen, but having that treatment. He's in the low 90s, which is low normal, right? So that's really good. So that's affecting a lot of things. And so if you have been asking or praying, I just wanted to update everybody so that you know where he's at. We would appreciate your continued prayers for him as he recovers, and for my mom as well. It's kind of that whole family, which of course I'm 3 hours. Don't worry about me. It's not communicable over the phone. But my whole side of the family there is not doing so great. In your bulletin, you'll find a couple of things that might interest you. First thing I want to tell you is that on the back, you can tear off this little pre-perforated thing. You can tear that even in half again. And then you can use that response card there to let us know you are here today. Let us know how we can get a hold of you so that we can spam you. And we're not really going to do that, but just let us know you are here. Let us know how we can be praying for you. It was a difficult week, and I think want to thank many of you for coming out to Smitty's viewing and or the funeral service that was held on, it's all blurring together now. I don't even know what day it was, but it was this week. And I want to thank you if you made that a priority, and just want to say on behalf of the family, thank you so much for all of your care and concern and prayers and the ways that you have reached out. I just want to extend that to you. I do want to talk about one other thing. In your bulletin, there is a sample ballot. It looks like this. And this is, if you are a voting member, you will have the opportunity, is it next week? November 8th, yes. Next week, to cast your vote for some really important position within our church and for our church government. And so you'll see there a listing. And the reason we give this to you 2 weeks in advance, so we had it in the bulletin, I think, last week as well. The reason we give it to you 2 weeks in advance is because we want you to have time to prayerfully consider your responses to this ballot. Now, starting last year, you guys approved an amendment to our bylaws, which allows for somebody who's not able to be here, is a member in good standing, but is not able to be present next week to be able to vote, and they're able to do that. And all they have to do, as a reminder, is they have to request a ballot from the secretary, Pam. They can do that up to 2 weeks in advance, and then they have to have it returned by the end of the service next week when we count ballots. So that is something that is available to you. But I just wanted to make you aware of that so you can be praying about that. But then that kind of segues into the fact that this Tuesday is kind of an important day, right? Now, for many of you, perhaps, if you're like me, you don't have to raise your hand, but I have already voted, right? So I did I don't know how you feel about mail-in ballots, but I have, since we moved up here, I've just been doing mail-in ballots, Jennifer and I both. And I love it because it gives me some time to sit down and think through, because, you know, there's 35 or 40 things on there to vote for. It gives me time to research them individually and really, you know, when you walk, for me anyway, when I walk into a voting box, if there's 30 things there, I'm like, okay, which name do I recognize sometimes? And I don't feel like that's being a good steward of that responsibility. Here's what I want to encourage you to do. Whoever you're going to vote for, I want you to take, while you're taking time to pray over this ballot, I want you to take time to pray over that ballot, right? You can go find your specific precincts. I don't know how they divide them up, but you can go find your specific information, I think at vote411.org or something like that, where it will just list every person, every candidate that you have to vote on. It'll list their information side by side on particular issues and responses. And I found it to be a pretty useful place. But anyway, I would ask you to do this. Pray about how you're going to vote. And if you can vote with a clear conscience before the Lord, then I want to encourage you to do that. Because listen, we are Christians first. Before we are one party or another party, before we are one issue over another issue, we are Christians. And I want us to vote as though Jesus is our Lord and our leader. So I'm just going to encourage you to don't miss your opportunity. I've talked to some younger people who are like, I don't even know if I'm going to vote because my voice doesn't really matter. Listen, this is important. Take your opportunity, definitely do that, and pray over how you're going to vote. And that's all I've got to say about that. And I would just encourage you then, finally, in regards to that, whatever happens on Tuesday, regardless of the outcome, we are still Christians, first of all. Let's make sure that our speech is seasoned the way Christ would speak, right? That when we're interacting, like if you win and someone else loses, don't be all rub it in their face, you know, and that's not how Jesus would be. Because why? Because Jesus doesn't care. He cares about their heart, right? He cares about the relationship. So let's make sure that we are Christians first. It's kind of gross to see some of the ways that some Christians are responding online and things like that. And it's like, well, I thought you were a follower of Christ, so let's make sure that it seasons everything that we say and everything that we do. That's all I've got to say. That's all the lecture you're going to get from me today. I want to invite three special people forward today. We periodically, and sometimes more than once a year, but frequently once a year, we will do a new member recognition. And so I'm going to invite Dana and Mark and Eli, if you will come stand right up here, whatever safe distance you feel from each other. And I'm going to give you a copy of this, although you already know what this is because you've already read these. We've talked about them in our classes there. You can have that one. You can have that one. And you can have this one. This is just a copy of our, and I'm going to get out of the camera. This is just a copy of our statement of our member covenant that we have here at Trinity Church. And so these three individuals in front of you today have gone through a couple of classes we call our membership classes that include things like, who are we as a church? What do we believe? What are we about, right? We are about people, helping people find and follow Christ. And then what does that look like? How does that get dressed out? But they have prayerfully considered being a part, and you, for some of you are looking at my son, maybe he's a little young. He's 16, and you have to be 16 to be a voting member, so he's 16 and a half. So, you know, something for you to consider if that's an option, if that's something that you want to be involved in. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to read through this, and I want you to listen to this. I'm sorry I didn't plan far enough in advance to put them in the bulletin. But I want you to listen to this because this is what a person who is a participating member of Trinity Church agrees to. And then I'm going to ask you three to respond with "I do" when it's appropriate, or "we do" is fine as well. Having been led to repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ our Savior, we do now in the presence of God and this assembly most solemnly and joyfully enter into this covenant with one another as the body of Christ. What does that mean? Well, it means this. I have got to interact with them and hear their testimonies, and to the best of my knowledge, with the Holy Spirit living inside of me, I agree that they know Christ as their Lord and Savior. That is the most important thing. You've got to be a member of the family of God if you're going to be a member of a local family. We talk about that. It's so important. I don't want membership at Trinity Church ever to be a notch in someone's belt. So like when I get to heaven, I was a member at Trinity Church. Jesus, that is not the criteria for getting into heaven. So we want to make sure that the criteria is met, which is Jesus has forgiven you of your sins. He's the Lord of your life. And they all have affirmed that to me. So then here are the things that they are agreeing to. Number one, we covenant by the aid of the Holy Spirit to walk together in Christian love, to join in mutual labors for the kingdom of Christ, to strive loyally for the advancement of this church in holiness, knowledge, and love, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, and to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines. If you agree with that statement, would you please answer by saying, we do. We covenant to contribute cheerfully and regularly as God prospers us to the support of this church and its worldwide ministries. If you agree with that statement, would you please answer by saying, we do. We covenant to maintain private and family devotions where possible, to endeavor to bring early to a saving knowledge of Christ all over whom we have the care and influence, to walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in our dealings and faithful in our engagements. If you agree with that, would you please say, we do. We covenant further to watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy in feeling and courtesy in speech, and to be slow to take offense and always ready for reconciliation. If you agree with that, would you please say, we do. And then finally, we covenant to witness faithfully to the saving and keeping power of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, so that in every way we may bring lost men and women to a saving knowledge of Him. If you agree with that, would you please answer by saying, we do. And church, I want to encourage you, if you're a participating member, that is what you agreed to. Maybe as you were listening, something stood out to you and you're like, oh yeah, I forgot about that one. Whatever that might be, I want to encourage you that that is what you have said that you wanted to be a part of. So I would like to pray over you guys, and then maybe we'll give them a big round of applause when I'm done praying for them as we welcome them into our fellowship. God, we just come before you today, and I lift up these individuals. Thank you so much for their desire to be a part of our body here, even in these difficult times where we're stretched a little thin. And God, thank you that they recognize your calling on their heart and their life to stand up and raise their arms and say, hey, this is for me. God, I pray that you would help them supernaturally, that your Holy Spirit would help them to be true to this covenant that they've just made. God, that you help us as a church renew and refresh our covenant to one another and the way that we love each other and care for each other. God, I pray you'd bless them the rest of this day and the rest of this week as they go out, God, happy in the fact that they are officially a part of this local body. We lift them up to you, God, and we pray it in your Son's name. Amen. Would everybody just give them a big round of applause as we welcome into our congregation a couple of new members. You guys can be seated. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm going to read from John chapter 10, verse 22 through 30. Then came the festival of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus is in the temple courts walking in the Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were there gathered around him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testifies about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one."
This is a fun time for, I think, children of all ages during our service when we illustrate some of Christ's teaching for children of all ages. So you at home, you here today, please pay attention. Last month, we went through the parables of Jesus, had some fun with that, but hopefully we learned some things so we in our own lives can better follow him. This takes a step beyond that into the life of a famous apostle named Paul. And so today we're going to ask the youth of Trinity here to put on a little skit called Mission Possible.
Come in, Control. This is Agent XQ421.
Who?
I said this is XQ421.
Who?
This is XQ4. Good grief, Selma. It's me, Saul.
Oh, hi, Saul. What's the word?
I just reached the outskirts of Damascus, and I can see the targets now. Could be as many as 100 of them. Tell the boss not to worry. We'll shut these Jesus people down, and we'll bring an end to their church. My eyes, I can't see. What's going on?
Good morning, Saul. Oh.
Who are you?
You should know who I am. I am the one you are trying to shut down. The one who people you want to arrest in Damascus.
What do you want with me?
I want you to go into all the world and tell people about my son, Jesus.
Me? Tell the world about Jesus? But I've spent the last few years trying to stop people from believing in him.
And now you'll put all that energy to work for me. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, will be to preach the gospel throughout the world, even in Rome. You'll give sermons and write letters that will fan a flame that can never be extinguished. You'll be my ambassador, my missionary. You'll become one of the greatest agents to ever serve me.
Yes, Lord, I will serve you.
You're suffering temporary blindness because of my light. You'll go see a man named Ananias, who will restore your sight. I'll send others to give you further instructions.
Yes, of course. Whatever you ask.
Good, Mr. Saul. This mission will now self-destruct.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Saul, are you there? Speak to me, Saul. What's going on?
Sorry, Control. I'm on a new mission. I've changed to the other side.
Rendition of Saul's conversion on the road to Damascus, yes? He changed life entirely with a bright light that God shined into his life, even though a Coleman lantern didn't do much here. You saw what happened to Saul. And so we have here an example, even though children, you and me, maybe find it hard to follow Christ and listen for his mission in our lives. He gives each one of us a mission. We just have to listen and challenge. And that's why we're calling this series Mission Possible. It's not just up to us, but God working through us that we can follow him wherever he sends us, wherever he calls us to go. Our verse this month is Mark chapter 10, verse 27. All things are possible with God. Let that be a message of hope and encouragement to all children of all ages here today. Thank you. Mr. Smitty?
Let us come before our Father humbly and on bended knee. Father, we just give praise and honor that you have allowed us to come this far. Your mercy and your grace, so undeserving. We lift up our nation, Father, for we are in definitely perilous times, and we ask that you would search our hearts as we approach this Tuesday in voting, that we would honor you with how we vote. Lay upon our hearts the things that are important to you, not to man. We lift up the leaders of this nation, federal, state, and city. We ask that you would bring their hearts to you and that they would have your will in their goings on day by day. And Father, we lift up this congregation. We have so many that are in need of you for healing, for guidance. So many that I won't attempt to name all the names. You know the names, and so do we. Give them peace, comfort, and strength as we face this this day and the days coming. We just give you praise and honor, Father, and we lift this all up through the cleansing blood of your Son. Amen.
Thank you, Keith. That was a great prayer. And yes, and I say don't forget to vote on Tuesday if you haven't done so already. It's just such a great privilege in this nation that we live in that we have the freedom to do that. In so many other countries, they don't have that freedom. So something we don't want to take lightly. Let's go ahead and stand and sing The Church's One Foundation.
Water and the Word.
God through the storm, through anything that happens, you are God, you are Lord of all, through whatever happens on Tuesday, Lord, you are in control, just as you've always been, Lord, and we trust you. You are our master, you are our God, we follow you alone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning. It's good to see every one of you. And I want to thank you for just being here this morning and joining us. If you are in Children's Church, I don't think we had a slide up there for that, but you are dismissed at this time and you're welcome to head back to the Fellowship Hall. And I hear that their speakers are more interesting than me. So, hey, what can I say? We like to try to bring Jesus to people on their level, and so that's our opportunity. That's what Children's Church is all about. It's our opportunity to bring Jesus to kids on their level. I want you to think of a time, perhaps maybe even this week, when you were in the middle of a conflict with another person. Just picture that in your mind. And as you were talking, your words were going nowhere. Now, this can happen on social media. It can happen in person. And you begin maybe to have this thought. You know, I'm not sure they really want to hear what I'm saying. You ever have that experience? You're talking, and their ears appear to be working, like they're stuck to their head, right? English words are being spoken, but because of some complicated dynamics, maybe some history, maybe some pain, maybe some arrogance, the person is just not listening. Maybe you were that person this last week. You saw somebody come up to you, and you were like, I don't care what they say, I'm not listening, because you've got it out for them. The fact of the matter is that underneath our human relationships are various levels of brokenness and sinful filters, and the kind of words that we make, the kind of things that make people's words just kind of pass in one ear and out the other, things that cause us, even though we have ears, even though our eardrums work, even though their minds are functioning and to understand, even though we can maybe intellectually understand what's being said to us, we refuse to understand. We don't want to hear. And in effect, we give that person kind of the stiff arm, talk to the hand kind of thing, right? The frightening thing is that that's not only true about human relationships. I hope you can all relate to that. I hope that's not just me bearing my sins up here before you all. But that's an experience that I hope we all can relate to. But the fact is that's not just human relationships. It's also true about our relationship with God. See, the fact is that our human heart is so broken and our filter is so strong that, quite frankly, it's a miracle that anybody hears anything that God says to us. The fact of the matter is that life-giving words, like life-giving words from the Bible, can land on a hardened heart, and then they go nowhere. What's remarkable about this Gospel of John is this contrast we keep seeing between those who hear the words of Jesus and receive them, and then those who hear the words of Jesus, but they don't really hear them. They don't really land on them, right? They reject them out of hand because they are words coming from Jesus. Some people embrace Jesus' teaching, others reject them. Some people fall at his feet and worship, others pick up stones to kill him. In our text today, in John chapter 10, we see a very clear contrast as Jesus makes some profound statements. If you don't have a copy of the Word of God today, they are on the table as you came in today, and you're excused to go ahead and get up and grab one if you need one, or you can pull out your smartphone, whatever you need. John chapter 10 today, and to be honest with you, depending on what your orientation is regarding Jesus, like right now in this room or wherever you're hearing this message, we have many folks that are joining us online, you're going to hear John chapter 10, and some of you are going to hear that text and go, yes, this is awesome. And some of you are going to hear this text and go, that's offensive. And it all depends not on what you hear, but rather where you are, where you're at in terms of your relationship with Jesus. So before we even get into this text, I'm going to make an application right now, and it's this. As you've come to our Sunday gathering or tuned in to our Sunday gathering, what's the orientation of your heart as it relates to the Bible? Have you come with a bit of a chip on your shoulder for whatever reason? Go ahead. Try and make me listen, Aaron. Hope you got a couple of good illustrations in there that make me laugh. Then I'll listen. In between my checking up on social media, checking on my friends to see what they're up to today, being envious of them because they're still at home in bed, I'm going to listen, but I may not listen very intently. Or are you coming today with a heart that's moldable, a heart that's ready to receive, where you're leaning into the Word, not leaning away from it, right? You see, John wrote this gospel in order to help us to know how to believe. But here's the problem. You will never hear Jesus correctly if you don't want to listen. You'll never hear Jesus correctly if you don't first want to listen. So if you started out today with a bit of an attitude, you might want to pray, Lord, help me to change that attitude. Help me to want to listen. To say that positively, what this text shows us is that it's a miracle that anybody listens to Jesus. We're going to see this in this text in terms of what Jesus does, diagnosing the problem in these people who come to him in the temple area. But before we go any further, let's stop and pray. God, we just ask you to take over this morning. God, certainly I hope that you have been, and it's our desire, and we prayed about it before the service even started, God, that you would be glorified today. Through our singing and our hearts and our instruments and our speaking and our reading of the word, our prayers, God, that just everything about us would be submitted to you today. God, I pray that you'd be glorified. And I pray that in this moment that you would pierce each of our hearts, whether we're watching online from home or whether we're sitting in one of these chairs, God, that you would pierce our hearts. God, do with us as you see fit. We need you to step in and change us, make us who you want us to be. God, I pray you do that today in Jesus' name. Amen. So today we're going to answer three key questions. Number one, what's the problem? Number two, to whom do we belong? And then number three, what will we do? So what's our problem? To whom do we belong? And what will we do? The first then is, what's the problem? The text begins with a description of the setting for this conversation in verse 22. Look at verse 22. At that time, the feast of dedication took place at Jerusalem. It was winter. Now, for those of you who are history buffs, there's a little bit of a backstory here that I think that's somewhat interesting. This festival, the Feast of Dedication, was not a biblically mandated feast. Instead, it was a cultural event that was meant to celebrate a moment about 100 years before the birth of Jesus, where the temple was rededicated after it was desecrated. Here's what happened. In 167 BC, a Syrian leader named Antiochus Epiphanes attacked the city of Jerusalem. He entered into the temple, and to the dismay and to the disgust of the Jewish people, he set up a pagan altar in the middle of the temple courtyard. He started offering sacrifices to foreign gods in the middle of the most sacred place for the people of God. He was severe in his persecution of the Jewish people. He made it illegal to even possess the Jewish scriptures. And that under the leadership of a Jewish rebel then named Judas Maccabeus, the temple was recaptured and consecrated on December 25th, 164 BC. He was a hero. This festival then became known as the Festival of Lights, and it was designed to celebrate the dawning of freedom and the removal of oppressors who were persecuting the Jewish people. This feast later came to be known as Hanukkah and was very similar in its celebration. So what you need to know is that when Jesus walks into this temple area, there is this celebration that is both spiritual and political in nature. It marked the moment where Jewish people threw off those who were occupying their land and they purified their most sacred place of worship. And it's important for you to know, as we're walking through this text, that underneath Jesus' teaching in this text, just picture it, where he's standing in this moment, there's this political and social current that's going on. Because Jesus' day was not any different than our own. Is there a political and social current going on today? Absolutely. There are always social and spiritual and political currents that are running underneath of our culture. And in Jesus' time, it wasn't the problem of the Syrians from 167 BC. It was who that was occupying Jerusalem? Rome. Yeah, it was Rome. And the Jewish people were looking for Jesus to come and liberate them, right? And to get Rome off their backs and return the Jewish nation to what she had been in the kind of gleaming jewel days of when David was king. You see, part of the problem with Jesus' teaching here is that it regularly collided with accepted spiritual truths and political ideology in the culture. Jesus was challenging the Jews to consider a very important question, which is this: which kingdom do you belong to? Do you belong to the kingdom of God? Or do you belong to the kingdom of men? Good question for us as believers today. And part of the tragedy of what is happening in Israel was that the Jewish people were consistently pledging their allegiance to the nation of Israel instead of pledging their allegiance to the God of the nation of Israel. You know, that's still an issue that we have to think about today, right? Like this week. Friends, we have to regularly think about where does the order of Christian fall in your thinking about life. So, for instance, if you're in business, if you're a business leader and you're climbing up the corporate ladder, you have to think, are you a businessman or a businesswoman who happens to be a Christian? Or are you a Christian who happens to be a business leader? Are you a voter who happens to be a Christian? Or are you a Christian who happens to be a voter? There's a world of difference. If you're in the realm of politics, you got to decide, am I a politician who happens to be a Christian, or am I a Christian who happens to serve in the public arena in politics? If you serve as a teacher or someone who's in sales or somebody who serves at any level in our culture, you got to think through, where does being a Christian fall in the order of prioritization? Because what Jesus is getting at here is that there are spiritual realities, and the people who were in control, who were in power, they were very nervous about this, right? Because what Jesus was teaching was likely to cause them to lose their position and maybe even lose their nation. Listen to what John records in John chapter 11. So if you're in John, you can jump ahead a little bit, or I'll have it on the screen. Verse 48. They say this about Jesus: if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. This is the fear of the people that Jesus is talking to. So I don't think it's by accident or from mere chronology that John mentions where Jesus is when this conversation takes place. Now, verse 23 tells us this, back in chapter 10, and Jesus was walking in the temple and in the colonnade of Solomon. This was a large section within the Temple Mount area where the early church actually gathered, according to Acts chapter 3 and Acts chapter 5, if you want to look that up. And the point is that Jesus is in the center of both the theological and political and socioeconomic capital of the Jewish nation. So that informs how we read verse 24. All that is background, verse 24. So the Jews gathered around him, like they gather around him at the Feast of Dedication in Solomon's colonnade area, right? And said to him, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. Now, when you and I read the word Christ, you probably think Jesus on the cross, right? We can't divorce that from our understanding because we've got 20/20 vision. But they're not thinking that, right? They're like, you tell us if you're the one who's going to get Rome off our back. That's what they're thinking. Like, we need another hammer, right? That's what Judas Maccabeus' nickname was. He was the hammer, right? And he was a guerrilla warfare insurrectionist, right? And they wanted to know, are you the guy that's going to take this over and become the new king so that Rome can be gone? Are you the one who's going to restore the glory of Israel? Tell us plainly if you're that guy. They're frustrated that Jesus, in their opinion, is not being clear about who he is. Look at chapter 10 and verse 19. There was a division that's going on about Jesus. We looked at this last week. Many of them said he has a demon and is insane. Why listen to him? Others said, these are not the words of one who's oppressed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind? So people have varying opinions about who Jesus is. And what's fascinating and telling here is the fact that they blame Jesus, because in their mind, the conflict that is being created in their culture is because Jesus just simply isn't being clear. Tell us, are you the Christ or not? The problem is that their definition of Christ and his definition of Christ were worlds apart. They had no category for a suffering, humble, giving up his rights sort of redeemer. They thought the problem was Rome when the real problem was their unrighteousness. Look at Jesus' answer in verse 25 because it gets to the heart of the problem. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. There it is. And then he says this, the works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. That's essential. Jesus told them who he was. The problem was not his lack of clarity. The problem was their lack of belief. They had another image of what the Messiah was going to look like, and he didn't fit into their box. Jesus didn't fit into their expectations. He confronted the idols of their hearts. His works should have been enough to convince them as to who he was, but the problem was not his lack of plainness in Jesus' words, but rather the hardness of their own hearts. And that's why Jesus tells them that the reason that they do not believe and the reason that they don't understand him is because they are not among his sheep. Jesus, in effect, tells them, you don't hear me. You can't hear me because you're not mine. So these people are coming to Jesus for all the wrong reasons. And just so you know, that didn't stop in the first century. Take your Bible and go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Let me show you this. I'll have it on the screen as well. When the Apostle Paul is talking about the challenge of the gospel going out into the world, he describes us human beings as being blinded by the enemy. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 3, he says this, 2 Corinthians 4:3, and even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, here's what he said, this is so critical, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. So Paul's idea is this, that the enemy blinds people's eyes. What's the natural condition? That's the natural condition of our hearts. And then there are things in the world that the enemy uses in order to keep people in their blindness. Things like what? Well, like pride. People who are convinced, I can do this on my own. I don't need anybody's help. I certainly don't need God's help. I got this. I am my own creator of my own destiny. And then, praise God, cancer comes. Or a funeral happens. Just happened this week, right? And you're met face to face with the reality, I am not in control of my life. Another way people are blinded, pride, but another way people are blinded is compassion. They know they've done wrong things, but they are a comparison. I'm sorry. They know they've done wrong things, but they compare themselves to others. And, well, at least I'm not like so-and-so. And as a result, there's this level of blindness that settles over them. Another way in which people are blinded is because of power. They can't embrace humility, right? They see everybody else being successful by taking what belongs to them and climbing on top of other people. And when Jesus says, become a servant, that seems counterintuitive to everything that's in the culture. And people are like, nah, I can't do that. I can't give up myself. They're so blinded. I don't want to follow some sort of sacrificial, mamby-pamby leader who dies. And what they don't know is that that was his means to ultimate victory. Some people are blinded because of control. They don't want someone else to control their life. They don't want the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to control their life. They don't want somebody to tell them what to do. They don't like the Bible because they don't like what's right and wrong in here, right? And as a result, they're like, no, I'm going to make my own law. And little do they know, while making their own law, they pave their way to destruction. Some people are blinded because of affections. They just love the wrong things. There are so many others that I could list. And if you're a follower of Jesus, what issues in your life stood in your way before Jesus broke through? What was it? You can probably think of them, can't you? And you know, when you tell Jesus about what it means, people about what it means to follow Jesus, you ought to tell them about that. You know, once I was like this, but now I'm like this. Once I used to think this way, and now I think this way. In fact, John Newton, who famously wrote Amazing Grace, he's a converted slave trader. Remember these words. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. That word wretch, we need to bring that back, right, into our vocabulary, right? I'm not just a sinner, I'm a wretch, right? Hashtag wretch, right? Something like that, I don't know. I once was lost, but now am, what's the next word? I once was lost, but now am found. 'Twas blind, but now I, what? See, that's right. That's what Jesus does. I was a wretch, now, for some hard to even understand reason, I'm a son. I was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, now I can see. And people who follow Jesus know, I didn't do that. I didn't earn that. I didn't climb that mountain. Jesus did that to me. Jesus found me. Jesus helped me to see, open my eyes. Jesus made me something that I wasn't. You see, beloved, the problem is not the lack of plainness in Jesus' words. No, no, no. The problem is the hardness of our hearts. That's why 4 years ago you could have heard this exact same sermon and you may have never heard a word that I said. But now you're here and God's done something in you and you're hearing the words of the Bible and you're like, oh, this is awesome. Right? But 4 years ago, you would have said, well, that's stupid. Why are people even waste their time? But here you are. God in his grace loved you. He sought you, and you are named among those that Jesus calls his sheep. You were wretched, and now you're one of his sheep. So what John does here is he identifies the problem. The problem is that we don't hear because we don't want to. Secondly, the question we need to wrestle with then is this. Okay, then to whom do we belong? Because what Jesus does is he links this notion of not hearing to not belonging to Jesus. Look at verse 27. He says this, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. The challenge is that Jesus is saying, you don't hear my voice because you're not part of my sheep. You don't belong to me. Those who belong to Jesus hear him. In fact, if you want to notice something really powerful about verses 27 to 30, I want you to follow along as I read it in a particular way. You can just follow along in your Bible. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand, because I and the Father are one. See, that text has everything to do with Jesus. Don't you dare read that text and be like, that text is about me. It's not about you. That text is about Jesus. These sheep are the ones who belong to him, and because they belong to him, they hear him, they are known by him, and they follow him. They don't hear, and then they become followers, become his sheep. Mm-hmm. They belong to him, and then they hear his voice. The hearing is a result of the belonging. And here we see a great mystery as it relates to the sovereignty of God over salvation. I just want to acknowledge a tension that exists within this text. The Bible is full of tensions, right? And I think God wants to teach us something through those. And for that matter, the first tension is this, that on the one hand, human beings are called to believe, and we are held responsible for our rejection of the gospel. You could see this all over in texts like Acts chapter 6 and verse 22 to 23 and 36 to 40 as an example. The Bible calls you to believe, and if you don't believe, that's on you. And at the same time, the Bible says, no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. He told Nicodemus, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So when Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice, it's a rebuke of those that are questioning Jesus. He's telling them that their problem is not that they hear. The problem is not what Jesus is saying. Listen to me. It is who they are. Their problem is so much deeper than what they ever even knew. He tells them that their real problem is that they don't belong to Jesus. And if they don't belong to him, they're never going to hear him. This great mystery in this context is meant to be put on the table, right? To be laid at our feet, if you will, for us to realize that there is this unbelievable mystery that God calls people to believe, and yet there's no way that they're going to believe unless he moves. And there are things like this in the Bible to make us go, wow. Consider for a moment, if you're a follower of Jesus, that he came into your world, not only as a child, not only as a man that was hung on a cross, but the moment when you heard the gospel and you believed that you didn't believe what you didn't believe before, that God was at work in you. Did you believe? 100% you believed. But did you believe by yourself? 100% no. And what Jesus is doing here is he's inviting these people and anyone who hears these words to consider who they are and to consider to whom do they really belong. Verse 28, look at what it says. It says this, I give them eternal life and they will never perish. And listen, no one will snatch them out of my hand. If you're a follower of Jesus and you belong to him, you hear those words and you're like, that's amazing. And if you're not a follower of him, you read those words and you're like, that's offensive. Part of the aim of Jesus' words is to break our hearts because the barrier to belief is a heart that isn't broken. So if you're a follower of Jesus, why do you hear Jesus' words even now? It's because of Jesus. Why do you follow Jesus? Because of Jesus. Why do you have any hope for eternal life? Because of Jesus. Why can you have confidence that you'll never perish? Because of Jesus. And what is your confidence that you're going to be able to persevere all the way to the end? It's only because of Jesus. And when you stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he knows everything about your past, everything you've ever done, everything you've ever thought, your only hope on that day is the only reason I'm here and safe is because of Jesus. So listen, behind your conversion, underneath your spiritual growth, and in front of your future is the power of God, which is why Jesus says, I and the Father are one. The security of the believer is rooted in who the good shepherd is, and that's why the Apostle Paul says this in Colossians chapter 3, your life is hidden with Christ in God. So listen to me. If you're a believer in Jesus, that means nothing, nothing, nothing can penetrate the vault of God's love for you. No sin, no trial, no temptation, no illness. The devil himself does not have the key to unlock the vault of God's love for you. That means that because you belong to Jesus, you are 100% safe. Your assurance doesn't come from a date in the front of your Bible or something you can remember. As important as those things are, and those things aren't immaterial, but at the end of the day, your hope for your future and your ability to persevere all the way to the end is nothing short of the fact that Jesus is the one who rescued you. Jesus was the one who saved you. And Jesus is the one who's going to keep you safe all the way to the end. So being a disciple of Jesus flows from belonging to Christ. Being a part of his church means that you belong to one another. And we gather together regularly to remind ourselves about the importance of this belonging. If you don't get belonging right, you don't get anything right. It's that foundational. It's like in an argument, if you're married, maybe with your spouse, or even just with a really good friend, if you're in an argument, if you're starting to get after each other or a little bit chippy in a conversation, it's time for a timeout, right? And to hold hands and to be reminded that we love one another, right? Sing Kumbaya or something like that. I don't know. I'm for you. I'm not against you. I know our words aren't connecting right now, but I'm in your corner. We got to be reminded that we belong to Jesus. And finally, then, what will you do? The text concludes with the response of the Jews in verse 31. The Jews picked up stones again to stone him, and then Jesus, right, he's in a tough spot. He's got people with stones in their hands, and they are ready to kill him. So Jesus, as wise as a serpent, as innocent as a dove, says, I have shown you many good works from the Father. For which of them are you going to stone me?" The Jews answered him, "It is not for a good work that we are going to stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself God." Then Jesus, I think here, in order to make them put down their stones for a moment, he asks them a confusing question, right? We don't have time to explore this, but let me summarize it this way. He says this in verse 34, Is it not written in your law, I said you are gods? He quotes Psalm 82:6. If he called them gods to whom the word of God came, and scripture cannot be broken, do you say of him whom the Father consecrated and sent me into the world, you are blaspheming because I said I am the Son of God? I understand it's confusing. It's meant to be, right? What's Jesus doing here? What's he doing? Why is he saying this? He wants them to think for a moment and be a little confused. They're ready to stone him. So he quotes kind of an obscure passage in Psalm 82 because he wants them to start having kind of these kind of thoughts. But wait a minute. What passage did he quote again? Psalm 82, does it really say that? And Jesus, I think, is buying some time here by using the scriptures against them. That's what I think he's doing. And then he offers them another invitation, verse 37. If I am not doing the works of my Father, then do not believe me. But if I do them, even though you do not believe me, believe the works. So he's still appealing for them to believe, that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father. And notice it once again fell on deaf ears. 39, again they sought to arrest him, but he escaped from their hands. You see, friends, it doesn't matter what Jesus does. It doesn't matter what Jesus says. It doesn't matter who he claims to be. Even though he's in the temple during this festival of lights, they are just not going to believe. Why? Because their hearts are set against him, and as a result, their ears are closed. And perhaps, maybe that describes someone who's hearing my voice even today. Like, no matter what I do, no matter what I say, no matter how many times it comes at you, you're going to find any way that you can to not believe what the Bible says. Because the problem isn't the preacher, it isn't the message, it's not the text. If you look carefully, the problem is you don't want to listen. And until you acknowledge that, you're never going to hear. So the text ends in verse 40. He went away again across the Jordan to the place where John had been baptizing at first, and there he remained. And many came to him, and they said, John did no sign, but everything that John said about this man was true, and many believed in him there. So the question we've got to ask ourselves is this: are you listening? Are you listening? It could be that you're hearing my voice today and you wouldn't identify as a Christian. But here's the crazy thing that's happening to you. While you're listening to this sermon, although you started at the very beginning thinking, I'm not really going to listen, I'm doing it for some other reason, suddenly now there's a little tiny door that's opening a crack and the light's starting to shine through. And if you're starting to have that thought, you need to know that I actually, and you're thinking, you know, I might actually be believing this. And friend, if that's happening, you need to know that it is by God, his Spirit, that's at work in you. And that is the means that God draws people to himself. So why not come to Jesus today? Why not just kind of kick that door all the way open and say, Jesus, I'm coming. My heart has been broken and I'm not going to resist any longer. Instead, I'm going to turn away from my sins. I want you to be my Savior and Lord and say to him, I believe, I want to follow you. Why not make that today? Or risk thinking, I'll wait till the next sermon. When you never know if the next sermon is even going to land on your heart any differently than this one is landing today. To those of you who are Christians, you should marvel. Oh, you should marvel. We should all marvel that we ever heard this glorious news in the first place. Do you remember the moment when the good news broke into your heart and your life? Do you remember the miracle when you saw, and it doesn't matter if you were young or old, but you saw the beauty of what God was offering to you in Jesus? Do you remember the miracle of that moment? You ought to thank God for that miracle. And all those, there are all sorts of really deep and important truths as to how all of that happened. The singular thing that you should be thinking about that miracle at that moment, in this moment, is this: why you? Like, seriously, why you? God set his love on you. He pursued you. He rescued you. He bought you. He went after you. He drew you. Why you? And the only answer is, I don't know. Because I'm a wretch. I was blind, but now I see. I was lost, but he found me. Don't you dare come to this text and go, well, he got me because, you know, I was a good catch, right? I was really smart. It was good for the kingdom, you know, when he chose me. No. If you think like that, you have not been caught, right? You're back to being lost again. Maybe you're a Christian here today and you know Jesus as your Savior, but your heart has not been very open to what the Bible says recently. Maybe because of pride or power or knowledge or experience. Can I just remind you that that it was the educated religious people that were in power who rejected Jesus' religious teaching? It was broken people who flooded to him. Maybe you're here today and you're a weary-hearted Christian, right? Troubled by the failures of your own life, maybe even in this last week, or maybe a physical issue that has caused like clouds to form over your soul. Maybe the devil is doing all sorts of evil things around you, and you might wonder, I don't know how I'm going to do this. Maybe you're in a hard marriage or in a tough spot at work, and you're like, I don't know, I'm scared. Let me assure you, brother or sister, that underneath your life is not your own strength. Underneath your life is not your own ingenuity. Underneath your life is not your knowledge. Underneath your life, the foundation of what it means to be a Christian is this simple promise. I belong to Jesus. So when difficulties or trials or hardships come, that statement needs to be on the forefront of your mind to help you to persevere. So when cancer comes, you can say, no, I belong to Jesus. When relationships disappoint you, I belong to Jesus. When you need to ask someone's forgiveness, you can say, I belong to Jesus. Or when the fear of man takes over and you can say, I belong to Jesus. Or when there are difficulties that you face and you wonder, I don't know if I have the strength to do this one more day, that the underlying reality of your life is, I belong to Jesus. Do you believe me? You belong to Jesus. Say it with me. I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. Say it again. I belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. Because church, your only hope in this life is this glorious truth found in John chapter 10 and verse 27. My sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish and no one will snatch them out of my hand. You can't snatch you out of his hand. The devil can't snatch you out of his hand. No one can snatch you out of his hand. Why? Because at the end of the day, you belong to Jesus. Won't you stand with me as we pray and prepare to close our service? Lord, help us. Because that truth is so important, and yet it's so easy for us to neglect and to forget the way in which that truth should be lived. So God, help us to hear today what you're saying. And I wonder today, if you're not yet a Christian, why not come to Jesus right now? Friend, why not just simply say, Jesus, I hear you. I hear you through this word today, and I turn from my sins right now, and I'm asking you, and I don't know what all of it means, but I know this, I need help, and I'm asking you to come and take over in me right now. Maybe you're a Christian and your soul is just so weary, and you could say, Jesus, despite blank, and fill in the blank, it's been good to be reminded that I belong to you. Oh, help us, Lord, to live in the power of what it means to belong to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
And pull. I will not fear when darkness falls. His strength will help me scale these walls. I see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like
come to you, and we're so grateful that you love us, that you care for us. God, who would we be? Where would we be without you? Bunch of wretches. But you reached down, you reached into our lives, you drew us to yourself. God, we love you. Our only response can be gratitude. Thank you so much for the salvation that you make available to each of us here this morning. God, if there's anybody who has yet to kind of make that decision and kind of cross that line, I pray that through your Holy Spirit, that you would be glorified, that they would respond to you today and become a member of the family of God. Oh God, accomplish your purposes in us this week. Help us, forefront of our minds, to think about what it means to belong to you. We pray it in your son's name. Amen. Thank you so much for coming today. If you want to talk to one of the elders or myself, we'll be up here at the front after the service. You are dismissed, and we'll kind of dismiss slowly. Let the people behind you get out first. Thanks for coming. Go and be the church.
I'm proud that you were able to locate your mask quickly now.